Hello everyone, let's discuss a very important topic from the basics of inorganic chemistry, and that is BSEPR theory. We also have another name for it, which is called as VSEPD theory. What exactly is VSEPD and VSEPR? I'll just let you know. Well, it is one of the basic topics, and almost every one of the chemistry students will be knowing it. VSEPR is abbreviated as valence shell electron pair repulsion theory. In the topic of chemical bonding, where the different types of bonds are explained, starting from ionic bond, covalent bond, dative bond or coordinate covalent bond, along with that we also have some secondary bonds such as metallic bonds. That metallic bond could be a localized or a delocalized bond. Later on we also have agostic bond, hydrogen bond and so on. With respect to the covalent bond, which is a directional bond, it has a directional property and it can also give rise to certain geometries, especially considered for the main group elements. So when I say it has a directional property, we also define how are these bonds directed and what is the geometry for a particular given molecule or a corresponding ion. To explain the geometries of such molecules, there was a beautiful theory that was put forward by Sedgwick and Powell. Later this was developed by Gillespie and Nyholm. How to understand this theory? I'll just put it in simpler form. Whatever molecule that I choose, the atoms are classified into two types. For our convenience, just let me classify them into two types. One, I am putting it as a central atom, it will be only one. The another one, we call them as surrounding atoms. At an advanced level, we also call them as ligands. Usually the term ligand is used in the coordination complexes, but at the advanced level of VSEPR, we also use the term ligands for the surrounding atoms. So we have put the atoms of a molecule into two types. One is the central atom, the another one is the surrounding atom. This is a theory that concentrates mostly on the central atom. What are the valence electrons of the central atom, how they are bound to the surrounding atoms, and after bonding to the surrounding atoms, are there any electrons that are left out? Depending on the electrons that are left out, that could also decide the geometry of a given molecule. So let's look at the different types of electrons. Whatever electrons that are present around the central atom and the electrons of the corresponding surrounding atoms, we are just classifying them into two types for our convenience. One, let's call it as bonding pair. These are the electrons that participate in the bond formation. And the other electrons that do not participate in the bond formation, these are called as non-bonding pair or lone pair of electrons. Now there are some central atoms where you don't find the localized pair of electrons, instead you find only a localized electron. So instead of being a pair, it is a single electron. For that reason, we can simply call it as a single electron, or it is a non-bonding electron. A single electron is nothing but a lone electron. Not a lone pair, but a lone electron. We find very few examples for a single electron to be localized on the given central atom. Right? So for our convenience, we have classified the atoms of a given molecule into two types. the central atom and the surrounding atoms. All the electrons that are surrounding the main central atom and also the electron coming from the surrounding atoms, we have classified them into two types. One is called as a bonding pair, the another one is called as a non-bonding pair, or you can call it as a lone pair, but whenever there is a single electron, you can simply call it as a lone electron or a non-bonding electron. Next important part is to understand how do these pair of electrons interact with one another. This VACPR theory concentrates on the molecules that come out from the main group, not for the transition elements, but at an advanced level even the transitional complexes are also considered for VACPR theory, but in the beginning stages it was applicable only for the main group elements. For this main group, the central atom is considered to be a spherical one because the valency orbitals are considered to be s and p orbitals, and these are considered to be giving a spherical shape to an atom. So if the surrounding atom or if the central atom is spherical, then the surrounding atoms can come and bind to this spherical central atom. How do they bind? Just suppose that I am putting two bond pairs. Imagine that I have put two bond pairs. Each of these bond pair is a pair of electrons. This is also a pair of electrons. Like charges repel each other and they try to repel one another and move to a distance where the repulsive forces are the least. So when I put two bonds from 0 till 360 degree, they try to move to such an angle where the repulsive forces are the least, and they try to occupy an angle where each bond makes a 180 degree angle to one another. So VACPR theory simply says that whenever two bonds are present, two bonding pairs without any lone pair of electrons, then they arrange with a bond angle of 180 degree that gives a linear structure. Mind you, there is no lone pair of electron. Suppose if I try to put one more bond here. Now the bond angle between these two bonds is 180 degree, but the bond angle between these two is just 90 degree, where the repulsive forces are larger. So whenever I add three bonds, then those three bonds will arrange in such a way that the repulsive forces are the least. Therefore, it takes a trigonal planar geometry. And if I try to put one more bond, now the bond angle is much, much closer. So what it tries to do is, instead of being a planar structure, now it will take up a three-dimensional structure, and that will be a tetrahedron. So if this is one bond, now slowly it is taking up a tetrahedral structure. That is how the VACPR theory explains. Okay, one important point that I'd like to tell you is, supposing that I choose the central atom, let me choose the central atom. There are some valence electrons for this central atom, right? And let me label it as A. Supposing that it is bonding to B, it is also bonding to some C, and it is bonding to D. This is just a hypothetical molecule. It is just a hypothetical molecule. And imagine that we also have a lone pair. Whenever we have a lone pair, you have to imagine that this lone pair is a localized pair. It is localized on the central atom. But wherever you have a bond pair, now this is considered to be a bond pair. This is a bond pair which is present between the two combining atoms, the central atom and the surrounding atom. So the space occupied by this bonding pair around the central atom is always less when I compare it with the space occupied by this localized lone pair of electrons. To put it simply, a lone pair will occupy a larger space, whereas a bond pair will occupy a smaller space with respect to the central atom. All these things are with respect to the central atom. This is localized, therefore it is occupying a greater space. This is in between A and B, therefore it is occupying a lesser space with respect to the central atom. Now whatever space that an electron pair occupy, we call that space as a domain. This is one domain which is being occupied. This is a second domain. Domain means the space occupied by an electron pair, let it be bonding or let it be a non-bonding electron pair. A is bound to C with a double bond. One is a single bond, another one is a sigma, the another one is a pi bond. But let it be a double bond or let it be a triple bond, this is the space which is occupied between A and C. This is the space that is occupied between A and D. Forget about the multiple bond. Let there be two bonds, let there be three bonds, but this is one space which is occupied between A and D. This is one space which is occupied between A and C, only one space. So a double bond is also considered as single domain. It is just one space, one domain. Or let it be a triple bond, this is also considered as one domain. Now let's come to some conclusions again. The space that is occupied around the central atom by some bonding pair or non-bonding pair is called as domain. Domain could be coming from a multiple bond, let it be from a double bond or a triple bond. You have to consider it as a single domain and a single domain. Once you are aware of these domains, since this is a space which is occupied around the central atom, this will give you some number. Number is one, there is one space that is occupied, second, third and fourth. So it is giving you altogether four. And these domains we call it as steric number. Steric number. So what is the steric number of this ABCD molecule? Means the steric number is 4. How did I get that 4? One is coming from the lone pair, one from a single bond, one from a double bond, one from a triple bond. Let there be a multiple bond, it will still occupy only one space between the central atom and the corresponding surrounding atom. So for a given steric number, there is always a particular hybridization. And for a particular hybridization, there is a particular geometry. Since it is with respect to these domains, we are giving a steric number. With respect to that steric number, we are giving hybridization. And with respect to hybridization, we are proposing a particular structure. Everything is surrounding the domain or the space occupied around the central atom. Hence, this theory is also called as valency shell electron pair domain theory. D stands for domain. What are these steric numbers and the corresponding hybridizations and geometries? In brief, I'll just put it in a form of a table. This is only for your understanding, because we have the parent geometry, which is also called as the electronic geometry. Later on, depending on the number of electron pairs, you could also get molecular geometry. Steric number, we start from 2. We just take up to 7. And the geometry that I'm giving is the parent geometry. It could be parent geometry or it could be the electronic geometry. Molecular geometry will be discussed in a separate class. Whenever the steric number is 2, hybridization proposed is sp. For 3 it is sp2, for 4 it is sp3, for 5 it is sp3d, where a dz square is involved, for 6 sp3d2 and for 7 sp3d3. And the corresponding geometries are linear. For sp2 it is trigonal planar. Since the parent geometry is considered to be more symmetrical, we call it as an equilateral triangle. sp3 is tetrahedral. And for sp3d, it is trigonal bipyramidal. Depending on the number of the lone pairs, the molecular geometry will change. It could be a seesaw, or it could be a T-shape and so on, or it could also be linear, emerging out from trigonal bipyramidal parent geometry. Octahedra. And the last one is pentagonal bipyramidal. Well, this is the steric number, corresponding hybridization and the corresponding geometry. So once I choose a molecule, we have to give some symbolism to that molecule. Axe symbolism is used, and for a corresponding axe symbolism, what are the number of bond pairs, what are the number of lone pairs that are present, and corresponding geometries. All these things will be discussed in a separate class. Thank you.